I would like to open the meeting of the Deerfield Planning Board on Monday, April 4th, 2016, at 7 o'clock here at the town offices in South Deerfield. And we have a quorum. Max, Kip, Rachel, John, and Paul. Excellent. And Doug is our stenographer.
I'm just hanging out. I can if you'd like. Yes.
So on our agenda is a call to order. We've done that. We potentially had a public hearing, but that might not happen. Then we review the minutes from March 7th, take public comment, look at some old business, and then our new business is a site plan application from Eagle Brook School for a solar array project. And then we have an A&R from the town of Deerfield, the Stillwater and Sand Gully Roads. We can look at our correspondence and then set a date for the next meeting. Is there anything else people would like on the agenda? All right. So we had talked about having a public hearing at the beginning of this meeting to talk about the zoning bylaw change to allow self-storage warehousing in C1, C2, and industrial zones. But
I think that might have been my fault because I didn't get the minutes to Doug. I thought I had, and when I looked this morning, I said nope. So
I'll share blame with him if you'd like. But
I'll take some too.
The public notice was posted at town hall 2 weeks ago. However, it was not published in the newspaper.
That's what
per state requirement. Right. That being said, there is still time to do this prior to town meeting if this committee chooses to have a special hearing specifically to hold a public hearing. No earlier than the 20th of April. If you choose to meet on either that Wednesday or the Thursday or that Friday to do the public hearing, we can put it on the town meeting warrant. Or it is on the town meeting warrant, I should say, so.
It's on there
I would
now.
Ask,
it's on
the how warrant. Important is it? Is it super important? Then we should.
Well, I guess the question also is zoning bylaw changes need a town meeting vote.
Correct.
So, and we only have that every
once a year,
maybe twice a year.
Two-thirds.
Yeah. Right.
I also anticipate that this is not going to be a contentious zoning bylaw change.
Right.
As evidenced by the number of people that are here, because some people could have thought it was going to happen. So I also wonder, one time we did a public hearing a half hour or an hour before the town meeting.
The marijuana thing,
yeah.
So I'm wondering.
Was that a public hearing? It was.
Yeah, it
so
was.
Perhaps we could do that again.
You want to schedule it for the half hour or an hour before the town meeting on the 25th? That's possible.
If it's legal.
You say the earliest we could do is the 20th, have a special meeting. That's the weekend. I don't know how we would really do it.
And honestly.
The 20th is a Wednesday.
Public comment. That's not a half bad time to do it.
Exactly.
Right there, people could come a little earlier to the evening. I mean. We didn't have that night. We had a few people come.
Yeah,
we did. We had a few people come, and that was good. I mean, they came and then they stayed on for the meeting.
Yeah, that
so
was that because Billadu was there. I remember that there were several people there
thinking
that they had.
And we're going to have to explain it at town meeting anyway.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
Because we want people to vote on it.
Okay.
So it's not half bad.
I will say at the outset, we should double check. In order to have a public hearing, do we have to have a quorum? The planning
board? Yes. It's a regular meeting.
I will be away that week. So are enough of you?
I'll be here.
Are there's going to be here?
Yeah.
You need five.
Four people, I think we can do that.
Yeah, four is usually around for town meeting. So.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. All right, so let's do that then.
Okay.
April 25th, town meeting, 6:30 p.m.
What town meeting starts at 7?
Town meeting starts at 7.
6 or 6:30? I don't know. What?
6.
Let's play it safe. Do it 6 in case some people do come. And
okay. Really, I'd like to add to that is that in our discussions, we were going to change that to all the commercial and residential areas, C2.
C1, C2, industrial.
And
not residential.
PI too.
But I think that we need to include it in C1 and the expedited permitting district because that can be used as a business area even though it's under a different setup with the Board of Selectmen. And I go back to, I remembered when there were some zoning changes back, and this goes back to 1990, but I did remember, and I was looking up.
Under the minutes, Kip, it says C1, C2, I, and BI. And you're saying add EPD onto it.
Right, and the reason for that is because there was zoning changes at the time which divided the town into small business, commercial, light industrial, and industrial. And there were certain uses that were allowed in some and not in the other. And the Attorney General disallowed all of those bylaws, even though they were approved at town meeting, because Section 4 of the Mass General Laws 40, Section A, provides that any zoning or bylaw which divides a city and towns into districts shall be uniform within that district for each class or kind or structure or use permitted. So, you know, it would be, I think it's kind of foolish, or we're wasting our time if we're going to pass it for certain districts and leave that one out.
Why did we? We had a reason, though.
There was discussion at the last meeting.
Yeah. Right.
Because EPD, what it was meant to be,
right,
in that it's, in my opinion, it's underutilized for storage. That's why in the last meeting we purposely left it out. And because it is an EPD district, I don't think that it would be legal, because it is a special district, my opinion.
Right. But
basically, our last meeting, we said to not do EPD, and you're asking to change it to EPD, right?
Because if we don't, and it moves forward, the Attorney General will strike down all of it, and so we're just wasting our time.
I'm having a hard time with that, because so many of our uses here are
excluded.
Yes, no, SP, you know, they're
well,
not.
The thing is because I'm not sure how to properly phase this, but because we're only proposing this use and that it be done by special permit anyways, it's not a matter of right. That's why I'm saying we need to include it in all of those areas. And it still needs to go for the special permit and go through whatever requirements for the special permit required. But if we omit the EPD, then there's a good possibility that the whole thing's just going to be struck down.
But if you look in our use table, there's a lot of items that have special permits other places but have no's in EPD. Mm-hmm. So you're saying you think all of them are not mm-hmm. proper?
Mm-hmm.
Well, yes. I'd like to get, we should get a legal okay. legal opinion on this, because that's crazy.
That's,
I mean, if we've been doing our use table incorrectly
business.
All these years, we
should. Well, and also,
I don't think we have, so I'd like to know where you came up with this and what our attorney would say about it.
What was it in response to?
It was from the district attorney to the town of Deerfield.
In 1990?
Yeah.
And you don't think other things have changed since then that we don't need to listen to?
Well,
that?
I read the law is still the same.
Mm-hmm. It hasn't changed.
What the town does is might have changed, but the law is still the same.
I mean, our use table has several items here that have.
But if that were the case, wouldn't that mean that having districts is moot? That's why I guess I'm having a hard time wrapping my head around that. I think it would be prudent for legal opinion.
Yeah. Well, this is Bill Lino. This is Lero. Right.
So I would suggest that for this reason, I don't think we should add it, because we've got plenty of other things that don't have a no in EPD but have special permits in other areas. If you think that it's it should be a special permit because we want it there, then that's another discussion. But like you said, last time we talked about it, because it's not really job creation, so it's not.
Yeah, but I'm also wondering that there was no such thing as EPD in 1990. So
right.
How does that play into this too? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It does make sense if you're saying all of C1. You're not, you know, higgity-piggitying C1. So
right.
What EPD does sort of do is separate one out. But because it's another zone, I think it is an interesting. Yeah. I think it would be something that council would have to look at, because the language of that is kind of.
I just thought I'd bring it to your attention.
Yeah.
No, that's good. So let's follow through on that.
Okay, I'll bring it, Doug, in the next.
Do you
few
want
days.
To get a legal opinion on whether or not?
Yes.
Whether or not you can exclude the EPD from the zoning change.
And look at
and
all of our use
else.
Tables
if
and find out, is anything else if in fact...
The language of it says you can't exclude. Now, does that mean that within the district you can't exclude? Let's C1, you can't make different exclusions? That makes sense. But is EPD... Yeah, I know, that's why the language is a little... it's specific to a case that isn't our case in front of us now, so it would have to be re...
Again, I guess I missed the whole point of that, Kip. What is the reason again?
What it says is that, and when you divide a town into different districts, you know, whether you call it small business, commercial, light industrial, that, you know, you can't restrict, you have to be uniformed in the districts for each class and kind of structure and use permitted. So in other words, you can't say in C1 you can build a brick building, but in C2 you can't build a brick building. Or in C1 you can have...
I think it means that it says within C1 you can't make discriminations either to C1, but are you saying EPD is part of...
No, I'm not saying EPD. I'm just saying it's another district.
Right, it's another district. Right.
But it's a special
and
district.
It says that, you know, once again, provides that any zoning bylaw which divides a city or town into districts shall be uniform within the districts for each class or kind of structure or use permitted.
Right, within the district. So it needs to be uniform within C1, within C2.
And EPD is deliberately designed to not be anything
within any of those.
It's a totally independent thing from all the other zones.
It is, but... Yeah. You know, the only reason I brought it forward is because there can be a commercial use in there. It could be a residential use in there. So it could even be an industrial use.
Town has got the committee that did that has decided what they intend it could be used for, and
right,
they wrote that zoning to match what they thought they might want to see there.
Yeah.
So.
My opinion only, but I don't think that we need to spend money on legal counsel on this. I think it's right. That's just my opinion.
I think I could probably make a phone call and get an answer in about 2 minutes.
Yeah.
Particularly if I forward it.
Get a copy of this.
Do you have a copy of that letter?
I will need a copy of that.
Yeah, that's how you do it, sure.
Yeah, and if we keep the phone call under 5 minutes, they don't bill us for it, so... So we're there with a stopwatch, let me tell you.
Yeah. All right, So we'll keep the same proposed zoning bylaw that we have, and we'll have the public hearing at 6 o'clock.
Okay, now this is...
April 25th.
Okay. Are you going to take the minutes for the whole meeting, Doug?
Sure, why not?
Okay, good. Because we're doing it out of order. This would have been old business, right?
Yes.
Because the next thing was review the minutes, and we went...
I know, but the public hearing was going to be
first.
Yeah,
that's okay.
I'll put that under old business. That's fine.
I am here on the 25th. Deerfield Town Meeting. I'm not here on election day. Okay. All right, great.
Draft and ballot now.
And we all got the... did we all get the memo about how to post things properly? So we'll also be better that I think the day after our meetings, one of us needs to go to Doug and say, okay, this is an official thing. We need to post it, and then you'll take it and do the thing. Great. All right, review of minutes. We got some minutes from the March 7th. So if we take a minute to read these, to review them. It should be noted that Roger came in, actually.
Yeah, I put him down as... So we have a full contingent tonight.
Yes, nice.
So, I would just say, because this is my business tonight, that my departure wasn't noted, which is fine, but I wasn't there after.
Yeah, it says...
Where does it say that? Oh, good. I was looking someplace else. Oh, yay.
Did you do it too late?
No, I think that's right. I was thinking it was before.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the minutes.
Is there a second? Do we have a second on the minutes?
I don't think.
Rachel, or me? I'll second him.
On
it's usually
on four, old business section two. We took up discussion of section 23 dimensional requirements regarding frontage and minimum lot size in RA. Discussion ensued, and the board decided to put the topic on the back burner. What does back burner mean? I thought we actually said, we voted to not.
I didn't. There was no official vote. There may have been a straw poll or something, but I don't remember. Was there an official vote?
No, but that should have been. Just say we want to discontinue discussion or something.
Yeah. No, discontinue rather than.
Makes it seem like we should bring it up next meeting or something.
Okay,
I think
all right.
We didn't want to. I think we were finished with the discussion.
Okay.
So if we change that to. Should we decided that we were finished with this topic?
Decided that we were.
Finished discussion with this topic?
Would you be taking it up again at a later meeting?
No, I don't think that
I mean, we could always take it up again, but it's not.
Start it up again.
It's like if someone wanted to bring it up again, but it's.
I think
so
we just.
We're not continuing.
You agreed to take no further action?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right? You're putting it down. You're not planning to pick it up or.
Yeah.
It's not like tabling it till the next meeting or something?
No, it wasn't tabled, no.
Okay.
And the board decided not to pursue further action.
Right.
Yeah.
Will be made.
All right, would that change? All in favor of accepting the minutes? Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstain. Max abstaining.
601. Okay.
So, public comment. Would anybody from the public like to make a comment? Great, thanks for coming.
This is probably the best place to put it. Under public comment, I wanted to let the planning board know that there's an individual or private developer who has been asking about self-storage warehouse possibilities in the town of Deerfield. Very interested in the town. In particular, he's interested in, ironically enough, the EPD. He is looking for a piece of land about that size and would be looking to develop the entire parcel as self-storage warehousing.
What entire parcel? The 12 or 14 acres?
The entire parcel. He's been informed that it's under contract until the end of June, and that New England Natural Bakers still has the right to purchase it. And I've also informed him that it's not zoned for self-storage. Mm-hmm. So to make use of that, even if it were available, it wouldn't be possible. But he's been persistent and dogged. And he continues to come back about once every month or so and say, what's going on, what's happening, what's new. So I thought I would let you know that there's someone who's knocking on the door looking to do some development in town. So there you are.
Thank you. I would ask if you see him again, you let him know that we took up the self-storage. It would have expanded the locations that it's available because we heard that there was a demand.
Yep. And he is aware of that.
Okay.
He is aware of that. And I've advised that he should certainly be looking at other parts of town in other zones, in the C1, the C2, or the industrial zones, and that there may be parcels available that might work for him. He keeps coming back to that one. So now you know.
Now we know. So this would also be a good time to say that there is a town meeting coming up on April 25th, and then elections May 2nd?
Correct.
Good. So we encourage all townspeople to turn out for those two events. New business. So actually, we have two new businesses. One is a site, it's a first reading of a site plan application for Eagle Brook, and I think
we flip it around, I can.
That's what I was going to say. This is going to be pretty quick, though, but Rachel has informed us that she has to recuse herself from anything about the Eagle Brook site plan application. And she submitted a signed letter. Should I give this to you, Doug?
Yes, please.
We have a signed one.
Or actually, just leave it in the packet.
You can read it.
It just says, as an employee of Eagle Brook School, I recuse myself from planning board activity pertaining to the special permit for the installation of a large-scale ground-mounted solar electric installation sought by Eagle Brook School.
Why don't you add pertaining to the special permit and site plan review?
And site plan review.
We're doing both. All right, so you're recused because I think this is going to be a 1 minute thing.
You may go away?
No, we want you to stay because there's another.
Well, she actually needs to leave. So she needs to go on the other side.
Yeah. And we've got three things to do, right?
Actually, yeah.
It looks like we've got three things to do under that. One is to review it. Two is to set the date, set the peer review and set the date, public hearing. And are we going to do that or not? I don't know.
I believe not. That's what I want to.
Okay.
That's
right,
why
good.
I think this is going to be quicker. So
yeah,
we got. We were informed today that the applicants wanted to put off the review of this because they're still dealing with the 61A.
Okay. All right.
Doug, you want to explain that a little bit?
I'm happy to. The property part, at least one of the parcels of property that is looking to be developed with solar power, it has been under Chapter 61A, agricultural conservation, for some years. This is a conservation restriction on the property that can be removed over the course of a period of about a year by basically ceasing to file the paperwork that are necessary every year, but then also requesting that the town release its right of first refusal. And there's that. And then after a year, and paying any back taxes that are owed, the property can be used as otherwise. Eagle Brook is looking to do that. They have consulted with the assessor's office, and they have every expectation to do that. At about 4:45 this afternoon, I did get a copy of a letter from Pam Stavirsky's office requesting that the board release their right of first refusal and waive the 120-day waiting period. The board has already informally spoken about this topic, and they have no interest in the property. They will very likely take about 20 seconds to vote on Wednesday to release their right of first refusal and waive the 120-day waiting period. Their meeting is on Wednesday. This will be on their docket, and so this may be resolved as of Thursday. So there's that.
So we had, and I think at the last meeting we had said we could sort of start our process a little if we had a complete application for site plan review, which I believe we do have now. And one of the first things we need to do is set a public hearing for it.
Mm-hmm.
And then we also had talked about getting an estimate from Pat Smith of the FERCOG.
That came this afternoon.
And that right came, so we can now give the applicant
$3,000
that estimate, sure. And they can make a deposit. And if it doesn't take us, I think it was for $3,000.
That's what I remember here reading, yeah.
And if it doesn't take that much, then it would be returned to them. That's the way our deposits are work. So,
but that didn't say not to exceed either, did it?
That's an estimate. When you're dealing with 53G accounts like this would be, if the peer review were to exceed the initial dollar estimates,
they'd pay.
The board has the possibility of going back to the applicant and requesting additional money.
Yeah, that was all I was saying, because I think the way it was being said, I think it was sounding like if there was any extra left over, then it would go back. That's fine, but
that's
if
correct.
There's anything on the other way, it should come to
the I had to do some research myself just to make sure that this was permissible, and it is completely. The one question I have is, how does the work that Pat Smith will be doing differ from the work that she normally does under the contract that she has with the town?
She responds to peer review stuff, I believe, on our part, and that's what she did in the previous project.
Okay. My question isn't necessarily related to this project, but more to the point, there is an existing contract with Pat Smith.
Right, but what Paul said is usually we get the peer review and then she reviews that. In this case, she's going to do the peer review, right?
Well, I don't agree with that, because what she did for us on the other solar project, was basically a peer review for us, and she does the work that we don't have the time to do. And she sits and reads everything and says, all right, does Section A comply with this bylaw and so that? And that's what we build the applicant for.
Right.
So to answer his question, I don't believe there is any real difference. All we wanted to know is an estimate from her how much time it was going to take to do the review of this project.
Mm.
So we could tell the applicant ahead of time what the possible charge would be.
But I understand where Doug's coming from and the legality of it, because what makes it different from her regular business with the board? Am I correct?
Yeah.
It's essentially what I'm
the
asking.
Applicant's going to be paying.
So it's different because this is specific to a project.
Sure.
And the way it was set up by the board is so that the monies didn't come out of the taxpayers' pockets, that the applicant pays for the time spent by the FERCOG as peer review agent. The way it was set up originally, it was a lump of money was taken in with no idea how much peer review and Pat Smith or the FERCOG's time would be, and we had to try to guess and estimate, but it came out of that funding.
Okay. Is this going to be the practice of the planning board basically from here forward? Do you see continuing to do this for larger projects?
I think if these projects come like this,
for
it would
large
be.
Large projects, yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's sort of the way it was set up like three or four meetings ago.
Yeah.
Okay.
But if I'm not mistaken, since I wasn't here for past projects, I don't believe that the board ever charged the applicant a peer review fee in a sense for their time, meaning the FERCOG's time. That bill was always paid by monies that were collected outside of that.
Well,
we kind of the solar project at the end of River Road was the first time where, Pat, I don't want to say the first time she billed us, it was the first time where the board applied that as a peer review. And that all came down because of the fee schedule. You know, we were trying to limit how much this fee was going to be and not burden the taxpayers. So, you know, during the discussions with the people from the solar array, you know, I made it perfectly clear, as well as they understood, that, you know, any time that was spent to review this for COG, they were going to be charged for. And that's the way it went down, because there is a lot of reading and comparing that none of us have the time to do. Now, well, I did read Pat's email, and that she seems to think, or I don't know, shouldn't say her, but her executive director and her legal counsel seem to think that it's a little bit different, and they want to, you know, make a different type of an agreement with the town for their peer review type thing. And I think that's okay. But it really isn't any different.
Well, when we set up the site plan review and these different things, we went through these different fees, and so we initially did set up the possibility of these fees being charged.
Exactly.
So it's I think it's perfectly applicable.
Oh, I think it is too. One of the other things historically was that the FERCOG has gotten grants. Do you remember the name of it? DLTA or
DLTA, Division of Local DLT grants, yeah.
And they used to get state money.
Local technical assistance.
And so we could, and I think...
We'd prioritize them and then we could get the grant for a specific thing.
Yeah, and so there were some times, and I think we did save applicants, we didn't bill applicants because there was that state grant so that we could use the FERCOG for some of this work. Over the past year, we've been using the town's budget. Our budget last year was, what, $7,500 or something.
Sure.
We're using that to pay her. And we can't keep doing that. So that's no, so me. I think historically things have changed a little, and they probably might change again because if we get a grant. But
if we have Pat come here to help us, you know, redo a zoning bylaw or some other language, something like that, that comes out of
that's on the town's dime.
But if she's spending time reviewing an
specific project
yeah. then that's different. Yep. You know, and she could, you know, I know she wouldn't double bill for her time here, but you know, she can definitely figure out how much time she spends at our meeting talking about a zoning change than how much is on a site plan review and bill accordingly.
And I think that's what her and her,
exactly.
her group wanted to be very conscious of.
Right, right. I think that second contract would solve the problem, wouldn't it?
And while we're talking about her email, she also told us that we'd used up all the money for the fiscal year already. So we still have to do something to...
I don't believe we have, actually. I think you're about $5,000 out of the $6,500 that was appropriated.
Well, did you read her email? Did it say that to you, or did I misread it?
She talked about having a contract that's good up to $10,000.
Yeah, she used all the money, but I...
You don't have that money.
From that financial statement that I looked at, that John had...
It was confusing to me because I thought we had money left.
No, we had... I thought
okay,
we had...
Let's stick on... I'm sorry, okay. We're going off on a...
All right.
Subject. So, all right, so we are going to have her do the peer review. So we can get... started, so I got to just double check that
she will have to negotiate, send the agreement to them directly, I believe, won't?
No, it comes to the town.
Oh, it does go through the town?
The town employs the peer review consultant. The town collects the money from the developer, puts it into a special account.
Okay.
It's held in escrow in order to pay that peer review consultant. But the town is the hiring agent, which means that the work that the peer review consultant does belongs to the town. In the end.
Okay.
So I just want to find the actual...
what are you looking for?
Site plan review application?
It's in the big brown folder, which is outside the box.
Right outside behind the box.
There you go.
Oh, because there's the other one. That's the
A&R, and that's the big...
All right.
There you go. There are 9 copies of everything separately clipped together.
All right, so we have... special permit application.
This this timeline thing, is this...
That's based on the site plan review bylaw.
Right, but it says that the town received it tomorrow.
Correct. Because the town has not officially received it, Pat Smith made it clear that it does not get officially received until it goes to the town clerk. It has not yet been to the town clerk's office, and therefore...
Then we've got nothing to do with it.
Well, we have to decide tonight whether to accept it or take it in.
Yeah, I just want to make sure that...
I mean, if we... Because the time clock starts.
So we have a check for $2,842. So that's
$2,842 is the site plan review fee that was calculated, given the amount of disturbed area. There should be another check, I think, of $100, which is the stormwater fee for the stormwater permit.
Oh, great.
There was no fee collected for the special permit. That I don't know if that has been determined, but my understanding is that when there's a special permit that runs coincident to a site plan review, that the two are run concurrently.
Right.
A special permit fee, if it were to be charged, would be equal to the site plan review fee, $2,842. And so the fact that you've already collected that, plus the $100 stormwater, plus upwards of $3,000 for peer review.
All right, so that all looks like it's in good shape. All right, so this will now go to...
It will literally just get time stamped by the town clerk tomorrow.
By the town clerk tomorrow.
First thing.
It says two arrays. I thought there was...
I thought there was three, yeah.
No, so...
Sorry?
This says two arrays.
They talked about three last month.
So...
I don't know anything.
Oh, well, was the third one the one that's got the 61A on it, maybe?
I do not know.
No. They're talking about the Keats Road one, and then they're talking about the second array will be located adjacent to an existing faculty house located off Rice Ferry Road.
And then there was another parcel somewhere, too.
I thought so, but yeah. Anyway.
Is that, what application are you looking at?
Site plan review application.
Okay.
When we talked last month, there was three parcels instead of two.
They may be counting that second because they're very close together. I don't know.
That's what I'm wondering, if they're both right next to each other, maybe. So. All right, so we've got all these copies. Does this get distributed to...
The paper copies are for the board here, yeah.
Read that way. That way. One for me. All right, and then the special permit, that, as you said, it goes with the same.
I believe there's enough copies of that for everyone.
Then. And then I think this is all on email too. Is that how we get it to Pat, or should I make a?
We have it in electronic format.
Can make right. A set for. And then
scan everything as a matter of course. So we have digital copies.
And then here's the $100 check for the stormwater permit.
Are there separate copies for all that stormwater thing as well?
Yeah. Six. Who wants Well.
Should be enough for everyone.
This is the original, which I don't want to mess with. This is a little thicker. Does everybody want one?
Sorry?
If you printed them out.
Well, I think we're going to be... I'll read it online. I don't need paper. Okay, that's the application, and then of course there's the report. 4, 6, 7. So again, is anybody going to read this?
Well, you're going to throw
them. If you've already printed them out,
yeah.
I don't know. These came from the applicant, but we need to get at least one. Probably Dick should have. I mean, the building. We should keep a couple here.
If you just give me one copy, I can. What I'll likely do is scan everything and send it digitally to the folks that need it.
I don't mind getting it digitally rather than a hard copy myself.
Yeah, I don't really want this.
Talking about sending it out to the
Roger. Would you like
to the various folks for?
I'm going to read it.
Review comment.
Excellent. All right, so we'll get Pat working on it, and we'll set the... So when should we set a special, public hearing?
Well, we need to decide when our next meeting will be, because it usually conflicts with the voting.
Which it will, right?
Usually on a Monday.
So we have two proposals, actually, here is to go a day later, May 3rd, or go to the following Monday. I think we've done...
We've done both, but...
I will be away May 3rd. I'd prefer...
The 9th.
The 9th, if that...
It's fine.
...matters to anybody.
That's good by me.
Good yep. by me. The following, so it's the second Monday of May?
Right.
All right.
We've actually done very well at meeting our dates of meetings. There was a while there we just met all kinds of days on different times.
So we do have a timeline for this to keep it moving. So tonight is the first reading.
Well, now, would you have the public hearing on the 9th then instead of the 3rd, as it says in the...
Yeah, that's what I'm going to go through.
Okay, so we'll change that 3rd to the 9th then.
So then this gets distributed to people, and as site plan review and special permit, it goes out to lots of other departments, police, fire, all the rest of it. So we ask for those two boards get it back to us by April 18th, if it goes out to them in the next couple of days. And then we set the date for May 9th. So 21, at least 14 days. Is that when public hearing requires applicants?
If you're having a public hearing on May 9th, it has to be published in the newspaper at least 14 days prior to that.
Right.
I think the dates I put in there were farther than 14 days, but that's acceptable.
Yeah.
The 14 days is an at least kind of
at least 14 thing. Days.
And is there any place that they have to sign on these applications that gives us the right to go beyond that the term? Or is that not part of this one?
No, that's for A&Rs. We do that. We don't have it on this application.
Okay, I thought it was site.
This gives us 90 days. I don't think we can.
Okay.
I don't think we can waive it.
That's good then.
I think I won't make that meeting, so I'm just letting you know that's all.
The second Monday, yeah, I know.
That's right. Second Monday.
That's sometimes an issue with Roger.
Yep.
All right. But it sounds like we'll have a quorum. So
I could be mistaken, but I thought somewhere in Pat's email it said something about getting an applicant to sign that extension if it was applicable, only because of the 61A situation. If it starts tomorrow and if there's any holdups with it, you know, it could create a problem for us. Unless, would we at the time say it's incomplete and...
Or we call that a condition.
Okay.
That's an easy enough thing to just call it a condition.
Okay.
Especially hearing that this seems like it's going to go fine. But, yeah. All right, so then after the May 9th, if there's any more work to be done, we still would have time. The decision deadline is June 4th, so, yeah. So
June 4th is a Friday, or a Saturday, actually. Your regular meeting is on June 6th.
Ooh.
If you would like, I can wait to get the timestamp from the town clerk until Thursday, and that would make June 6th the last day of the review period.
And that would be after, when's the select board meeting about this thing, on Wednesday night?
Select board meeting on this?
No, on that 61A issue.
Oh, 61A.
Wednesday?
Yeah, 2 days from now.
Yeah.
Oh, so that would make sense then. Then right after that, then Thursday you call it a complete application.
Sure. Okay, fair enough.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If that's how you want to roll, that's good. I'm good with
well,
that.
Well, you made the suggestion. I thought it was a good one.
All right, there you go. Okay. The board...
All right, anything else about the Eagle Brook Solar Project? We will ask them to... We'll ask them to make a presentation on May 9th.
Had you talked to Pat about her email, any of that stuff before the email came out today? In other words, do they have some problem with legalities or something that they wanted to you know, change her.
Ooh, the FERCOG?
Yeah.
Oh, no. No, no, no. Once she sent this out, she said it was fine, though.
What they're doing is they're drawing up a contract specifically for work related to this project. They're going to put a bottom maximum price of $3,000 on it.
Oh, okay, so that was
and
just
going to
be...
And that'll be a contract that I sign with the FRCOG on behalf of the planning board.
Okay, all right. So that just was...
Once that happens, then that the applicant will be notified that there is a peer review fee of $3,000 due.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You are.
Okay.
As soon as we can collect that, then we'll move forward. If the applicant chooses to not pay that for some reason, you can reject the application at that point, if you choose to.
So,
I'm not suggesting that'll happen.
Right, correct, Doug. Did you say that this is a one-time deal just for this project? So going forward, every time would involve a new contract?
Yes.
Okay.
I think that's correct.
All right.
That's the way we talked about it originally.
Yeah.
As each one is a standalone project. And you have to keep a separate account, don't you, Doug?
The 53G account is a separate actual account. It's not just tracking the money. It's actually creating a separate account, putting the money in that account. It has to be an interest-bearing account.
For that particular project.
Right.
Exactly. Yeah. It's actually a lot of work for the accountant. But.
And then just to double-check that the site plan review fee is based on the area of disturbed land,
That goes into our $25,000.
They reported, revolving. If you look at this special permit, if you look at the site plan review application, area of disturbed land, $165,000? So what, I'm not sure what, all figures must be in square feet, so that's square feet. But what's, they have a total land area, and then area of disturbed land, but it's got that slash. So those are the two different parcels, I guess.
Right.
Which is weird. You see what I'm talking about?
Right, yeah.
So the total land area, if you look at the first one, it's 3 million square feet. And then over here,
right, that's the what is it?
61 acres.
Is that the Keats Road?
This is a special permit application.
That would be
okay.
The Keats Road, and then there's
but only 165 of that is being disturbed.
There, where it's got 3 million slash.
Or is it 936? No, I'm just looking. See the numbers down here.
I don't have a copy.
Which number
of what you've
goes,
got,
I don't get what the numbers go
down there.
Yes. Well, the
number seven.
I think there was an estimate of the actual disturbance on each one, and it's just because a parcel is 10 acres, doesn't mean that they're disturbing the entire parcel. I think that's an estimate by the engineer.
Yeah, this one right here, same thing.
The other that comes up to another issue. If they're
hold it. We got two conversations, Doug and Paul.
Paul and Roger. Yeah,
and
Roger
and I.
So well. He's trying to get the numbers of what he was talking about.
All right.
If you add up the amount of disturbed land and you multiply it times our rate of $10, it comes to be $11,000. Now, I know that we have a cap of $3,000, so that fee amount should be $3,250, not $2,850.
The fee amount was calculated based on the original submission of the original site plan review application, and if they've changed the site plan review application since that point,
I don't know. I'm just going by the numbers on the application of disturbed land.
So maybe that's something to check out over the next couple of days before we stamp it. Sorry, we just have to know what the numbers are we're dealing with, and if the max is $3,250, they should just pay that probably. Is this over a million?
Yeah.
I mean, the thing is, this slash thing, I don't understand.
There's two parcels of land.
John was saying, the first parcel was 3 million square feet, they were only disturbing 165 of that. The second parcel was, 1.5 million square feet, and they're disturbing 936. That's the way I'd assume it, because somebody like me has...
And above that, they have the book and page of the parcels.
Right above it, so that's cool. All right, so if you can just make sure those numbers match, Doug, that'd be great. All right, and this is going to go along so smooth.
Do you need to keep that, Doug?
I don't, if you need it back.
So anything else on that? we'll follow up with Pat, and then we'll have the special, the public hearing on May 9th.
May 9th, okay.
Great. All right, so then we have new business B as an A&R, and we'd love to have Rachel come back up. You've been so patient and kind.
You've been very well behaved, too.
John, not necessarily to go backwards, but under our old business in that meeting scene, under the minutes, it said new business. You know, the board will discuss the need to be alerted of plans that might affect the planning board by other town boards and committees. You know, and it just said that we'll table it till our next meeting, which is this meeting. Can that be solved as simple as just to request of the Board of Selectmen to let us know of any project coming before the town out of courtesy, and then we can stick our noses into it and see if we can help?
Can you come up with different wording? I agree with you. I just don't know if we want to.
Well, to let the board know so they can get our input on any pending, you know, projects, whether it's new construction, alterations, or repairs. Because that's one of our duties.
So you think all projects?
All projects.
We were talking.
No, I thought we said over a certain dollar amount.
Well, we talked about this in the capital, in reference to the capital improvements or capital.
Yeah,
budget.
But it's still our duty is to consider and advise upon, you know, all municipal improvements, whether at the request of other officials or upon our own initiative. But all I'm asking is that we be notified, because if we're not in the loop of, you know, if the library is going to need this or the whatever, you know, as long as they just tell us that this is something coming up, and then we can, you know, take the ball and run with it from there.
So let's, I think we're all in favor
of
that.
Oh, I'm in agreement with
that.
So
let's make a one sentence, and this is going to go, so we're asking the
Board of Selectmen just to notify the planning board of any projects.
Capital projects or any projects?
Any projects.
I mean, if there's a boiler going to be replaced.
I know. I think we need to
put
some.
Do we need that?
What's that? What do you call it? Infrastructure or capital projects? Because we don't want to know every time they get a new computer. I mean,
that's the thing. Yes.
Yeah. Well, we talked about.
I thought we had a price.
Putting, you know, I threw out the number 10,000 the last meeting, and I think that's what we're going to discuss. I think any project might be too much work.
Information.
You know, like we said, if you know, they're sending a computer out for repair.
Why don't we just use the words of our own bylaw and just say advise upon any municipal improvements?
Okay.
So municipal improvements is good.
Let's just use that.
Fair enough.
Where is that?
Any municipal.
Is that in the front of the?
It's chapter 37 of 37-4 of the duties of the planning board.
Yeah.
What's the reference again, please?
37-4, duties of the planning board. Look at that page. It also makes reference to Mass General Law, Chapter 41, Section 70 through 81X, that charges us with other duties. But I guess this the town's bylaw, you know, is further from that.
All right. So the Planning Board requests that the Select Board notify them of all municipal improvements. So that's a motion.
Do you want to put that in motion?
Yeah, I made a motion that we requested.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? 7-0-0. That doesn't happen all the time. Thank you for reminding us of that.
We lost our selectman.
A potential selectman.
A potential person to notify us.
Yeah.
So, A&R. The name of the applicant is the town of Deerfield.
good bastard.
What is the proposed changes? It's blank. Wow.
The town owns a parcel of land that forms the northern part of, I don't care if you know if you guys really want to look at this. The town owns a parcel of land that forms the northern part of the town landfill. Primarily along Sandfeld Road, but also comes across westerly to move up the Stillwater Road. At last year's town meeting,
Is there one more? Oh my gosh.
Last year's town meeting voted to give the Board of Selectmen approval or authority to dispose of this land.
We realized afterward that actually we needed the bulk of it to stay with the town landfill because it's in active use as a brush dump. So we've developed a plan to segment off the two northmost, basically that northernmost part of the land. Because each of them has frontage on a road, we decided to create two separate parcels of land. Those are the ones marked Lot 1 and Lot 2.
And these are not going to be sold?
I'm sorry?
These are not going to be sold?
These are going to be sold.
Oh, they are going to
yes.
be sold.
The remainder of the land, it's very hard to tell from this, and I'm actually very sad that the locus map isn't more complete and doesn't show the whole parcel. But the remainder of town-owned land is the section that's on the right-hand side of the map that you see. It's the part that includes a little bit of that, the old railway bed. And it extends down kind of along the in the shape of Georgia, if you will, down towards the stump dump.
That land was part of the permitting for the condos, and that was supposed to be open space.
The land there was part of the permitting for the condominiums?
The condominium, that was the whole idea, was that that was going to be like a buffer.
This was part of the original farm.
It was part of the original piece of land that Melnick sold to Upton.
Is there a restriction or something that you know of that's on that? Or more to the point, how did the town come into ownership of it?
Because Upton wanted to relieve the condo association of the taxes and still retain the open space.
That'd be interesting, because if that's the case, then the town shouldn't be selling it.
With open
well,
space.
I'm not seeing that. I haven't seen anything which puts an easement on that property or that there's a lien on that property. And it's a single contiguous piece running
from... But it was all part of that original property that Walter Milnick owned that was sold and developed.
So perhaps somehow, back then it was just done as a handshake. Yeah, we'll give this to the
well,
town.
Well, I think so before we cut it up in a building dump? Lot, you ought to look into it.
At some point, did Milnick own the town dump?
No, it's adjoined the town dump. This piece of land here is part of the condos, and it tied into the piece of land that comes in the back side of the dump.
Guess I'm not following that at all.
Well, in other words, what he's saying is
it's true.
I hear what he's saying.
Years ago.
I have no evidence to back that up. I haven't seen.
Well, I guess the easy part is how did the town get it? How did they acquire it? That's
right.
How, an easy thing.
Who deeded it to the town?
And that would give you the.
I would have to go and find out.
Yeah.
Maybe there was a plan somewhere in the registry of deeds.
Well, not that we've seen.
Okay, no plan. So
I think the town has always owned that piece of property. I think the town always owned that piece of property. For a long time, way before the condos were there, and you're
it was
talking
part
about
of
the land that Melnick bought from
Consolidated
back at
yes.
the tobacco company. I don't think that was part of it, Max. But I'm not 100% sure. But I don't. I believe that was town property for a long, long time.
They were separate.
Right.
Because the line. Anyways, I just.
Yeah, this doesn't have.
I just think
right.
rather than
there it is.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, I guess he's suggesting you should take a look at it and see if that's the case. I think the town has owned that. I don't think Consolidated, and I don't think Walter Melnick owned that property ever.
He owned the land on both sides of it.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean he owned that piece, Max.
Oh, yeah. I always thought it was one continuous piece because it was planted that way.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Well, if you go to the town's website, there's a connection to the Registry of Deeds, and you could look that up and you see when.
I'm very familiar with how with the Registry of Deeds, yes.
Okay. And that would give you the answer.
Yeah, I wasn't anticipating doing a title search for the property, but I can.
Well, whoever stamped this thing should have, but.
So your concern, Max, is that there would be some kind of.
The people bought these condos thinking this was going to be open space.
Open, exactly. So we'd potentially run a foul.
Well, they bought the condos thinking it was going to be open space.
But not with no assurance.
Right.
Unless there's a restriction on it.
Right, because you see, the town owns that land across the way, and I know for a fact there was, consolidated buildings over there. You know, I think it was part of the consolidated property, but
and then
I could be wrong.
A wooded lot.
Town owns this too.
Mm-hmm.
That was a wooded lot.
Yeah, that still is.
Right,
yeah.
But there was a barn. They cut that building lot. There was a building lot just
on the west side of Stillwater.
On the west side of Stillwater.
Yeah, it's the exact same dimensions north to south as this section here. But it only goes back about 180 feet, 200 feet. It's about an acre and a half.
There was a tobacco barn there.
Yeah, could very well be. That's also owned by the town at this point. And
there was, and now there's a house there.
Yep.
I would be concerned that somebody didn't look into this.
So as we remember, what are we supposed to look at with an A&R?
Well, that's
presented.
Yeah,
that's kind of where we're at. I mean, we were presented a plan, and
basically, it's asking to put this line in between.
Yep. That one line
and the horizontal line on the southern boundary, exactly.
Because that's not there now.
Yep.
Is it? Because on the map, this is all one piece.
But the condominiums, right, don't they have a line there? Or that's
so they're at this one's already established.
This is already here.
Yeah. So isn't
we're adding this one? And then
so it's just this line you're adding.
The original property.
This line and this line.
Does this.
And goes down there.
And keeps going that way.
Oh, I see. So from here over is right. What you're talking about. Okay, I gotcha.
That point was drawn from this dividing line of the condo property.
Yep,
we
went
from that point to create this.
Right, right.
Is that flat?
So it's this line and it's this line.
Correct.
Okay, I gotcha. I'm sorry. I thought you meant it was this whole line.
No.
Okay, I understand
that. That's just being defined as the southern boundary of both lots, but yes.
So then each lot has how much frontage?
At least 200 feet.
206.
230.
206.
230 down there.
206. Well over the.
It's got its
area requirement.
Yeah, and I think our only interest is we got to make sure it's got access to the property.
Sand Gully Road.
Yeah, they got the access. The frontage doesn't even matter to us either because we don't have to guarantee it, do we? As a board.
Well, no.
As a
frontage.
We're looking at it. It has the appropriate frontage, more than 200 feet of frontage.
Okay.
Yeah, but we don't care if it's a building lot or not.
No.
Because we don't approve as a building lot. They have to.
Did you say that on it?
No. All right, I'd like to make a motion that we
non-conforming.
Should not be construed as either the endorsement or an approval of zoning requirements. Mm-hmm. I guess that. So I have a question. Is the application complete? It's Do you know why this isn't filled in? Usually we write something here on the section that it says, what are the proposed changes to the plan?
I just didn't write in what was going to be changed. So that's my oversight.
Yeah, I mean, that needs to be written. Otherwise, it's a verbal thing. And I mean, this is what carries the day. But we didn't know this line was being added. So you should say. And the fee was waived?
Would you like the town to pay the town? I'm happy to do that if you'd like.
Just a little bit more accounting. And
Yes, we need to keep Brenda busy. Absolutely.
Just double checking. They didn't give us an extension. Well, either. tough group in the town.
Didn't.
All right, so we have a motion to endorse it?
I think I heard one.
Yeah. Second?
I'll second.
Any other discussion? Just note that you do write something in that section.
I will.
Five. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain?
Yes. I voted yes.
Yes, okay. Yeah, just
so is it 700?
700.
Okay.
Now, if Max thinks that there could be issues with it, I highly recommend that the town looks a little bit deeper. That's not our
purview.
I will. Trust me. Absolutely. I have to.
This seems like a good idea overall.
The schedule, assuming that these lots can be sold, the schedule is not to do anything with them until after well after July 1st. So we've got some time to just make sure that the province.
Doug, this is off topic, but you know, did the town really do their diligence to make sure that it is?
Last time I went by the end of San Gully and said road closed.
We didn't do a title search on the property.
No, that it truly is excess property that we will never.
We consulted with the heads, and the building commissioner was reviewed the plan. So.
No, I think
beyond that, I mean, we didn't do an exhaustive
I think it's a mistake.
Search of every single board or committee, but
so you don't want to sign.
But the board of selectmen are aware of what's happening, and
I guess what this is something that all boards, I think, should have been made aware of, that there was excess property coming up. But that's, I guess, my point.
I'll make that note.
Is that the Mylar over there?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, we gotta go.
That's the main one. It's gotta be signed.
We gotta go sign that. Sharpies in a long time, actually, I guess.
Have we got all enough signed copies here, then?
Or is this an extra one?
You've got plenty of signatures.
I don't know how many we got. What's that?
You've got enough signatures.
Okay. Well, this.
You want at least four signatures on these?
There's four.
Yeah. We need four? There's three. Yep, okay. And the bottom one in this pile is a
set? Hand that right over there to Paul. Yeah, I guess what I'm getting at, Doug, is, I mean, could that have been leased out for a solar array or, you know, what I'm saying? And I guess.
No village.
Well, given the fact that it's an RA, large-scale solar would be the only thing that would be effective, given the amount of square footage. It would be require site plan review and so on and so forth. That it's in a wooded area, you'd have to clear the lot of trees for solar. And actually, currently in the current economics of solar energy development, it doesn't make sense to do a darn thing with solar commercially or municipally until the state either, well, hopefully both lifts the cap on net metering as well as institutes a replacement for the SREC 2 program, which makes solar essentially fiscally valuable. We actually have a consultant that we're talking with about putting solar on the landfill.
Well, I didn't sign any of the other ones.
That's on hold until both of those things are changed, until both of those parameters change. So,
always.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
These are just all zoning variances.
Yeah, so we're just going through some mail here from town of Deerfield and town of Shelburne.
I just can't figure out 114 Main Street in Deerfield. There's another. I'm so curious what that is.
The citizen trainer, did everybody get there?
And this one is about
these,
a
trainings, don't we?
I think the one I got one in the mail at home. Does that sound right? Would they have sent it out to their houses?
Yeah.
I think we received an email also that I forwarded to the board.
So this is a 5 kilowatt.
I don't receive those.
Hmm.
On a rural reservation.
And there's a municipal conference coming up.
On April 9th, correct.
The one that Stan Rosenberg organizes?
It's a week from Saturday. Or this coming Saturday, actually, yeah.
Burkhardt people go.
Two of us from the office actually signed up to go just today, so it looks like there's still spots open if any of you choose to sign up. It's at GCC. It's his annual legislative conference that has been done in Northampton for the past several years. And there's some good topics, there's some good information coming. For what it's worth, both myself and Kat Dolan, who's the new administrative clerk, attended the Citizen Planner Training Conference that happened in Worcester a couple weekends ago. We both got a lot of great information out of it, including some real hope and some promise of a major change to the zoning laws at the state level. Chapter 40A is looking to see a major rehab. It's in committee right now, but hopefully over the course of this coming year, it'll be changed significantly.
What kinds of changes? What kind
The thing that we just signed, the ANR, that will no longer be allowed.
They're finally getting rid of the ANR.
They will be getting rid of the ANR. Everything will fall under the auspices of the subdivision bylaw or the subdivision regulations. So subdividing a land to create building lots will no longer be permitted by right. An ANR won't be allowed by right. There's a number of other regulations. Like, I don't know all the details. I haven't read it exhaustively. But, for example, there's one part of 40A, one section, one sentence has something like 285 words in this one sentence. And it's a series of exclusions, notwithstanding this, and in spite of that, and so on and so forth. So a lot of the language is going to get cleaned up. But functionally, with luck, it'll be a law that'll be cleaner, easier to understand, and that will address some of the concerns that planning boards have had for about the past 20 years.
So. I think Massachusetts and only one other state still
ANRs.
allows ANRs.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. There's also something which is going to be coming, I think it's going to be part of this, I know it's been discussed, something called, and forgive me, I don't even think I can remember the term, but if someone is putting in a subdivision, you can actually charge them a service fee when they create the subdivision, and that fee can be of multiple parts. Part of it goes to capital improvements for sewer. Part of it goes to capital improvements for water. Part of it goes into a special capital fund for schools, with the expectation that if you're creating a subdivision with 50 units, any one of which could have children in it, then they pay a fee for each one of those units when the development goes in. And that money then goes into a long-term stabilization fund for your schools. And it's a way to actually lessen the impact of new development on the town's infrastructure. This is something also that I think Massachusetts is one of two or three states that doesn't allow this. That's something they're looking to change, which would be tremendous.
What does this mean for us as far as changing our bylaws? It sounds like it's going to have quite an impact, so we're going to be very, very busy.
Yes. Yes. It's likely that we're going to need to do a comprehensive review of all of the bylaws if and when this goes into play. It's also possible that these state law changes will get phased in, so there will be some time to take care of that. But.
So we're going through some mail here, and there's one here that concerns Deerfield, and it's from, it's actually dated March 2nd. When was our last meeting? Was it
March the 7th?
Which one is that?
It's a notice of license application, residential dock. Dear boards, attaches a legal notice and a Chapter 91 license application for me to construct a seasonal dock and
appurtenances
in my backyard. Thank you. I currently have a notice of intent before the Conservation Commission and have filed a notice with MESA for an endangered species review. So this is on River Road.
Connecticut.
So it's on the Connecticut. It's 254 River Road. The application is from John J. Staberski. So the DEP licensing process requires that he provides this notice with an application. Should anyone have questions, feel free to contact him. And there's contact information here. And then he closes the letter saying, I fully appreciate This dock primarily benefits my family, but all town officials should know that it is at their disposal. Should, I wanted to end the sentence there, but it continues to say, should there ever be an emergency on the river, whether I am home or not. So that's...
There aren't very many docks.
I was going to say,
There's one off the Pollen.
There's a kayak up there, and there's not many.
They don't last long.
I took the scouts down the down the river and out by McClellan Farms. Is that on the Deerfield though?
This is on the
Connecticut.
This is on the Connecticut.
But is the McClellan Farm Road on the Deerfield, or is it on?
It's on both.
I know. It depends where on the road.
There's an old farmer there, and we had to go and talk to him to get permission to take our canoes out there. And he was kind of a cantankerous guy, but he did give the scouts the right to do it.
John, I don't think that really has anything to do with us. That was just informational. Am I wrong?
You are absolutely right, unless we have...
We want to have rights.
We weren't even asked for...
you want to use the dock.
Ask for opinion.
This is just...
You should know that it's at there.
Get your dibs in now.
Wait out the rest.
I'm all set.
We can all bring our boats.
Any other mail there that you saw?
It's just zoning for non-conforming on Church Street. Like, it's a kind of semi... They have something called semi-residential zoning in Greenfield.
Semi-residential?
Semi-residential.
For
it's
those people
right there
who
on
aren't
Church
quite
Street.
Residential?
Well, the
not
people
really
that
sure.
go to Florida half the year.
Some commercial activity on Church Street and a lot of houses. That's that interesting.
Is it Church Street
in Greenfield?
Greenfield. It's in Greenfield.
Oh, in Greenfield.
Yeah. Right by St. James. Goes past the...
Wow.
Semi-residential.
Mm-hmm. This one is for a 5.2 kilowatt ground-mounted solar photovoltaic on 114 Main Street.
Up on the roof of a building, it must be on a
ground mounted.
But is it ground mounted?
114 Main Street in Greenfield.
No, ground mounted.
This is Greenfield.
Greenfield. This is all Greenfield.
Wow.
Yeah. Ground mounted.
Wonder where that is.
I know.
I would be willing to bet
by the
it
church?
Is over a parking area.
Well, because no, then at the same place they're looking for a variance for converting an existing service station to a convenience store with the addition of a drive-through window or donut shop.
That's Planet Hot on the Mohawk Trail. They're doing the same thing, Mohawk Trail.
So maybe that's Planet. Where 114 is. 114 Main Street.
Oh, Main Street, okay.
114 Main Street, that's the convenience store up next to Ryan and Casey's.
Oh, the FDL Roberts?
I don't know if that's what it is. At least I think that's what it is.
Well, they did a ground-mounted solar on Conway Street School up on Allen Street in Greenfield. So maybe that's the same kind of thing.
That's very nice.
That is very nice.
Summit Distributing Company, but that doesn't tell you who. So that, I just have the question. So we have mail for review, and then we have this large folder that's archived mail.
Right.
Is someone on staff... Time to go through that and throw
that's
it out,
all or? Mail that was at least 2 or 3 months old, and I assumed that the board had already paid attention to it. So
right. So I'm just wondering when does it not show up in here?
When would you like it to not show up in there?
Now. I don't know what the previous administration. We didn't have much old stuff.
Okay. if you want it to go away after you've reviewed it, then we can leave the archive in the file cabinet.
Yeah, that's
probably we'd like okay. to hold on to it for 6 to 12 months.
We try to go through it if it looks like it's something relevant to Deerfield, or like if someone came up with a 6 megawatt solar, we might just be interested in how are they doing it, like because we did one. So
yes,
but otherwise we don't usually go back and look at old mail. So that's all we have. And we already set the date for the next meeting, and it's...
9th of May.
9th of May?
May 9th.
May 9th at 7 9. O'clock in the town hall.
Cinco de Mayo plus 4.
Tonight being the finals of the NCAA tournament. It's good that we're finishing early. Does anybody have anything else to add, or a motion to adjourn?
Just really quickly, would anybody be against on the board if I worked with Pat Smith... a little bit about the small scale solar, adjusting that a little bit as far as
what size
that would be. Right now it's up to 10,000 square feet, 10,000 watts, but I don't know if it should be looked at as more of a size thing than watts, because, you know, especially like now Tesla's coming out with the more affordable car. 10,000 watts right now is just enough to basically feed a small your average household, say around $200 worth of electricity, or not. I mean,
so you think we're going to see more of them? Is that what
I think we're going to probably see more of them. I don't care either way. It's just I think that is something that's going to be coming down the pipe.
Well, they're getting more efficient, so that the same physical size now is a higher rating.
Right. That's what I'm getting at. Yeah. When we did this about 5 years ago, I'm gonna guess and say that, or maybe even more, that a 10,000 watt system then was probably 20 or 30% larger than it is today. But it's up to
you're thinking increasing that cap, John.
Right. Doing it more of a size thing, you know, a square footage, dimensional size versus. But I don't know. I just think it's something that should be looked at. So I'm asking the board if I can have permission to work on that a little bit.
I guess, I mean, because anybody can do whatever they want, but I guess your question is to use some of Pat's time to do it. I would rather have that, have a discussion here about the issue, and then we would all sort of say.
That's fine. I brought it up a few times, and.
Really?
That's the first time I remember coming.
No, I'm positive. Okay, well then.
Here's the thing.
Consider this the first time then.
Yeah.
I guess.
Yeah, let's mark it down. John decided tonight.
I mean, I think certainly anybody in town, but certainly anybody on the planning board, if you have a issue that maybe we want to make changes in the zoning bylaws, we should put it on for at least 5 minutes on the agenda.
But do you think it's something that we should look at? I mean, I don't want to be.
I think it's going to come up more and more.
Yeah,
that's kind of way.
I think the whole zoning thing with solar panels should always be the physical size, not its capacity.
Right.
Because that's what affects people. Because if somebody's looking at something that's, you know, 10 by 10, well, they don't know if it's, you know, 10 kilowatts or a million kilowatts. It's the physical thing that could affect some people.
So maybe the next time that Pat Smith's in here, put a few minutes aside.
And where is small solar now?
It's defined in the solar bylaw.
There it is, small-scale ground-mounted. So it's yes everywhere.
Well, yes, but it's more the numbers that are applied to it and what has to be done.
No, I'm
small
just like,
scale is allowed everywhere. Right. It allows anybody.
Oh, I see what you're saying. I'm sorry. I didn't
to make some solar, for their own.
Allowed without review by the planning board.
Right. And about how many panels is that?
10,000 watts, you're probably looking, let's see.
300.
Well, I mean, different panels are different sizes.
Yeah, I think 300 is a pretty good
average. If you have 200 watt panels, they're.
And it's 50.
You're looking at probably,
John, when it comes to something like that, this is another such article that I think is something that is capable of us to do. We can just, change some numbers. I mean, nothing against the FERCOG, but why do we always have to hire Pat to do something? That's something that it's pretty simple that we could, if we agree that we want to change the size from 40 to 30 or vice versa, why can't we just do it and make the changes, you know?
Yeah, my question always is, I like to look at other towns. I think it's dangerous sometimes to just go off and do our own thing, and that's one thing that I like about the FERCOG is they look at many different towns, but that's easy enough for us to just.
Right.
Ask them, they could just give us a worksheet probably. That you're right, you don't have to spend a lot of time on it.
I'd also, if I may be so bold, you might also talk to folks who develop and build solar.
Yeah.
And get opinion, because they could provide you with technical specifics. And
sure.
So we're going to have someone at our next meeting who does solar.
Yeah.
That's great.
I just think there's going to be a larger demand for it coming down the pike, for regular people, homeowners that
you see more and more of
want an electric car and
more on roofs.
I would be really happy to work with
a lot
that.
Of places too.
Yeah, to start hashing out things and getting some information.
Because I just think solar is going to be the key to our energy future.
The only thing now is that we, if you get into solar, it is a great source of energy. But the cost of it is just so impractical. And if it wasn't for the government feeding everybody
right
money,
now,
you wouldn't see any of it.
Right now, you're right. But would you know?
Technology could change.
It is changing on a daily basis.
And I mean, our society is kind of bizarre. I mean, I like to keep the earth clean, but yet, and I'm not talking about the gas pipeline, but there's a lot of people opposed to this oil line that goes through the center of the country because they're afraid that it might spill. And I, too, would be afraid of that. But yet, our biggest source of pollution is air pollution, and all that oil gets loaded on a freight train, and those trains just go back and forth all the time. And just think of all the pollution you could prevent if that oil just flowed down a pipeline. But, you know, we're you know, so anyways.
All right, I was looking for a motion to adjourn.
John made a motion to adjourn.
Did I?
Yes, right. You did. John did, but nobody seconded it.
I'll second the motion.
But then you started talking about solar panels.
Seconded by Kip. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
7-0-0.